Hello, everyone. Welcome to the next session. The title is The Continuing Evolution of the Research Landscape, Amplifying the Voices and Influence of People with Lived Experience. I'm Carrie Thibodeau, the National Director of Programs and Public Policy for the Kidney Foundation. We're very excited to have you join us today for a discussion about participating in kidney research. Before we begin, I'd like to review with you how to participate. We're offering all forum sessions bilingually using simultaneous translation. During this session, our speakers will present in English. To hear the presentation in French, click the interpretation icon, which looks like a globe in the Zoom toolbar, and select English. We ask that you enter any questions you may have throughout the session in the Q&A pane below the video. We'll collect your questions, and at the end of the presentation, our speakers will address as many as they can. You'll also have an opportunity during the Q&A section to ask questions live as time permits. Please feel free to ask any questions that haven't been addressed and send them through to kidneyprograms@kidney.ca. For general comments during the session, there's a feedloop chat box just to the right of your screen. So that chat box is to be used for general chat. Please submit your questions through the Q&A pane so that they can be seen and addressed by the speakers today. The information shared in this session isn't intended to be medical advice. We recommend that you speak to your doctor about your own individual situation. I'd now like to introduce our moderator today and one of our speakers as well, Dr. Leanne Stocker. Leanne is the National Director of Research at the Kidney Foundation of Canada. She's based in Ontario, and she holds both a degree in molecular biology and genetics from the University of Guelph. She has a PhD in biochemistry and biomedical science from McMaster University, and is a professional research scientist with a varied background in both academic research and research management. Leanne has a long-standing interest in integrating research science, clinical development, and patient-facing programs. In this role, Leanne continues to provide the support needed to engage, empower, and support the kidney research community. She fulfills the Kidney Foundation's research strategies and ultimately improves outcomes for people with kidney disease. Leanne, the floor is yours.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Carrie, and thank you to everybody for joining us today. Before we get started, I would just like to recognize that although I am from Ontario and I am generally joining from between the lakes Purchase territory, I'm actually joining today from unceded territories, which is the city of Vancouver. And the city of Vancouver is situated on the unceded traditional lands of the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh Nations. And I just wanted to say, I took a moment yesterday to walk down to the water and stick my toes in the very cold water and just take a moment to recognize how beautiful this landscape is and to give some thanks and some appreciation to the elders and the people that are here with us today, were here with us before, and help to take care of the land on which we stand. My first job of today is to introduce our first two speakers. It's absolutely fantastic that they're here today to join us. I'd like to introduce Dr. Holly Mansell. Holly is an associate professor in the College of Pharmacy and Nutrition at the University of Saskatchewan. In addition to her pharmacy training, she completed a PhD in health sciences as well. Holly is a pharmacist who specializes in transplantation, but these days most of her time is spent on research and teaching pharmacy students. Most of her research focuses on transplantation, patient education, or cannabis and youth. She is continuously inspired by the patients and caregivers who share their lived experiences and the students that she mentors. Joining Holly today is Parag. Parag Trivedi received a live donor kidney transplant from his father in 2004, and this life-changing experience ignited Parag's commitment and everlasting desire to give back to his community and to make a positive impact on the lives of those around him and to focus on continuous internal growth. So Holly and Parag have joined us today and are going to give us a presentation discussing how they've been working together, how lived experience has been integrated into Holly's research program. And I hand the mic over to you, Holly.
Thank you so much for the introduction. I'm just going to try and share my screen here. So just to start off with, I'm joining you today from Treaty Territory 6 in the homeland of the Métis, and Prague is located in Treaty Territory 4. This is a view from my window, actually, but this is the summertime. It's a lot snowier today. It's very snowy where we are right now. But in all seasons, winter and summer both, we truly appreciate that we can work, play, and live on these lands. And so we give thanks to the ancestors of these places. So although we had a bit of a bio already, Prague and I both wanted to just kind of give a bit of a personal introduction as well. So I'm a health sciences researcher, but my first degree was in pharmacy, as mentioned. And so prior to working in academia at the university, I spent a number of years working as a pharmacist within the transplant program at our center in Saskatoon. And I feel fortunate now that I'm in a position where I can sort of research some of these questions that came up in practice and hopefully be part of some of the solutions. And Prague, I'll turn it to you here for you to say hi.
Hi guys, so thank you so much for joining. My name is Prague Trivedi. I am here today to share my experience as a transplant patient. But the white coat kind of gives away is that somehow through all of this, it's come full circle, and I'm actually a pharmacist that practices in Regina, Saskatchewan as well. But here today is my patient hat on.
So we wanted to keep this talk a bit more informal, and we have some time for discussion at the end, but nevertheless, it didn't really feel right to give you to start going without giving you some idea of what we might be talking about. And so our learning objectives today are to describe how a simple quality improvement project evolved into a research program. We want to show how patient and family involvement shaped our process, and we want to share what we learned about patient engagement. And so our story for today begins quite a while ago now. It's back in 2014. And as mentioned, I'm a pharmacist. And one of the responsibilities that transplant pharmacists have, or our pharmacist did at the hospital, was to provide medication teaching to patients about their medications before they went home after receiving their transplant. And so one of the things that myself and the other pharmacists noticed is that patients often seem surprised that they would have to take their medications for life, or their anti-rejection medications. And this always really bothered us because we felt like something critical was being missed. So we did try to provide information before the transplant, and we were providing written information and verbal information, but clearly we weren't doing enough because there was a gap between what we were providing and what patients were retaining or telling us. So I have a couple of quotes here that kind of highlight the problem from actual situations. The first one on the right, I used to see this one a lot. Do I have to take these medications forever? And then the second one that's on the left, I show this one because to me it's completely tragic. This patient said to us, because I can't read worth a darned, I fully didn't understand, it was the pig to the poke. And so we needed to do something. So the first thing we did is we consulted with the Patient and Family Advisory Committee within our institution, and they confirmed the need for more transplant education or something different. And we also spoke with other pharmacists from around the country, and they seemed to be having the same problem. And so from there, we went on to do a needs assessment. We weren't really sure to start, but this seemed sensible. And so this needs assessment had four different components. So we started by reviewing the literature. So we basically looked at what information was already out there on this topic. We also did an assessment of patients who were waiting for a kidney transplant to see what they knew about transplant medications. And we also enlisted the help of people who had previously had a transplant. And then we got input from healthcare providers as well. And you can see this is where we started to involve Prague. And at the time, we involved him as a patient. And he was in his pharmacy studies just very beginning, but definitely had his patient hat on. So just a little bit more about these studies. So basically what we decided to do is we had this clinical problem and we wanted to do something about it, but we also wanted to do it scientifically. And so we made these different projects into studies and we went on to publish the results too. And the reason we did this is because then we can share our results with other people, other centers, and they can learn what we found as well. And so the first one was really a descriptive study to learn what was done in our pre-transplant population and what people knew and felt about our teaching and the medications. And so we collected some information about where people live and their age and language and whether they had access to the internet. And we found surprisingly that 90% did. And we also had a spot for patients to sort of freely share their thoughts, like open-ended feedback. And we did this because we realized that sometimes as healthcare providers and researchers, we design a set of questions and we ask them, but often we're not asking the right questions. And so if we give people a chance to tell us exactly what they think, we thought this might help. And so we did learn that patients were not satisfied with what they were learning and their education, and that we were on the right track in thinking that we had to do something more. And so this led to kind of our next study. And basically what we did is we talked to patients using kind of a focus group form. And so at this point, we're really involving patients at the level of kind of like participants. And as a pharmacist at this point, I really assumed that whatever we would be doing or whatever we would be creating would really be about medication. But this patients taught us, this group of patients just taught us so much more. So we found out that there were misconceptions about medication, yes, but this was really just like a small part of what they wanted to know. There was a lot of talk about the testing on the wait list, and they couldn't understand what the tests were for. And some people even said that it felt like we were doing these tests to try and get them off the wait list. And they wanted to know about the surgery and the recovery, and there was just so much more. And so this is where our project got totally blown up. It was no longer just about medications. And I think it was really our first like aha moment as a team, because, you know, we realized that had we not asked patients at this point what they thought, then we would have missed the mark on what we would be doing and where we would go, be going to. And so the next study was a talk with healthcare providers. And so we did a focus group type of format as well. And at this point, we really involved Parag, because the healthcare providers on the team, we kind of felt like in order for them to share their opinions and their real thoughts, then it probably would be best if, you know, if me, for example, was not the interviewer. So Parag came along and he conducted the interviews, and he was instrumental in sort of completing this part of the project. And you can see he's actually a first author on this paper as well. And so interestingly, identified gaps were the same as really what had been identified by patients as well. And so early on in our needs assessment, we determined that we needed to create some sort of educational videos. And I realize this really doesn't seem like rocket science, but it was going to be kind of an improvement on what we were doing already, which was verbal information and paper. And also when we thought about it, there was a lot of reasons why this made sense. So first of all, you could provide consistent education the same way. So some of the things we heard from patients were that they were getting mixed messages from different people. It also allowed us for a way to provide illustrations and diagrams to help make somewhat confusing information maybe a little bit simpler by showing pictures. It didn't require more healthcare provider time, and it was a way that people could maybe take this education home and replay it as much as they wanted, or share it with patients. Or, you know, that whole waitlist process takes a long time, and so perhaps people want to rewatch things as things go on. We could also include information from a variety of sources. So for instance, we could feature other patients or healthcare providers. And then finally, I think, you know, one of the biggest reasons here is in red, it's the patient suggested it. And I have a quote here on the right that sort of speaks to that. So we continued and we ended up developing a 6-part mini series for patients on videos, and each video sort of explains a stage of the transplant process. And the videos range in length between 3 and 23 minutes. And we have this animated character who's kind of embarking on this transplant journey. And we really paid a lot of attention in terms of the music and the theme and the style. And we wanted it to be something that was engaging and that people actually wanted to watch. And we were so blessed to have over 35 patients who volunteered to share their help and their knowledge and their experience with transplant through these videos. So this is just a little bit of a picture of what they kind of look like. Basically, they're made up of segments of kind of animations and real clips interdispersed. And we didn't use any actors. So we didn't have anyone like pretend to be a patient or pretend to be a healthcare provider. all of the people we had in the videos were themselves and they spoke authentically. And I think that that really sort of helps to make the finished product what it is. So this slide here, it really only tells some of the story. It doesn't show all of the blood and the sweat and tears that went into the project. First, we had to find funding before we could even get started. And this was kind of a challenge because granting agencies, they want to fund research, but they always don't always want to fund education, which is what this kind of was. And so we also had to get multiple approvals. We had to get approvals for every different study. We had to get ethics for filming, of course, which is understandable, but that took a lot of time as well. And we didn't know anything about video production. And so we were learning from scratch. We consulted a lot of different experts, but even so, we didn't have enough funding to sort of hire a video producer. And a lot of the legwork we did ourselves, and Frog, we also had him walking around with a video camera and filming even in his spare time as well. And so we weren't efficient to start. Our script writing and narrating alone took about 200 hours, and we learned all kinds of things, and we learned what not to do for next time. The other thing I'd like to mention too is that we had patients kind of help us develop it, but then we had an external group review sort of to confirm that what we were presenting was in fact accurate and of utility. And then the other thing we did is we engaged a group of grade 9 students to review the videos because we thought if we can take this group of students that doesn't know anything about transplant and frankly doesn't care, and they understand what we're talking about and they're somewhat engaged, then, you know, I think we're on the right track. And so that was kind of like our litmus test. And so I'm moving into the evaluation now. So once we were done making the videos, it was really tempting to just like throw them out into the world. But as researchers, we have to remember that it's our responsibility to evaluate whatever it is we're doing, whether it's, you know, medication intervention or else education. So we want to make sure it's effective. And one of the questions we had is like, we went through all of this work to develop these videos. When is the right time to actually use them? Is it two patients before their transplant, or is it maybe we should show them two patients after their transplant? When is the information of most utility? And so we were lucky to get funding to take on two studies to answer this question. So the studies were multi-center studies, which means we had collaborators from other centers. So we had Saskatoon, Regina, Calgary, Edmonton, Vancouver, and also Chicago involved. And then we had patients as participants, and they were randomized, which is kind of like flipping a coin, and then patients end up in one of two groups. And so the healthcare team didn't know which group the patients were in. And one group received just kind of the usual education at the center. And the other group received the usual education, but also access to the videos to watch however they wanted, whenever they wanted, through the internet or DVDs if they preferred. And you'll notice I have a picture on the right. So this is Terry Steves Guernsey, and she is a patient as well. And we needed a research assistant in order to perform these studies. And serendipitously, we ended up hiring Terry. So Terry, it was kind of funny. She was in clinic one day and she was talking to one of the pharmacists about how she was retiring and how she needed a hobby. And Nicola totally latched onto that. She said, "Hey, do you want to be a research assistant?" And then, so of course, Terry was interested, and it turned out to be a really great collaboration for us. Patients responded really well to Terry, and we're certain because she knew what it was like. She could approach patients with empathy and understanding, and she really got a lot out of being part of this part of the project. So moving on to the evaluation, I'm just going to briefly tell you the results of our study. So the first one, again, was conducted in people before their transplant, and we had 132 people who completed the study. And in the group that received the videos, nearly 80% watched the videos either through their internet connection or through DVD. And when we compared the two groups between who had changes in knowledge and satisfaction, the changes in the knowledge and satisfaction were higher in the group that received the videos, which showed us that our study results were positive. And you can see here, we went on to publish these results as well. And we also had Prague involved, as well as another patient there as well. And they were involved in the writing and the publication. And we think that this is another kind of important way to involve patients as well, to, you know, have them be part of our team when we're writing these results up and being part of the publication. So in the second study, this was in the post-transplant period. And so people who had had their transplant were asked if they wanted to participate. And then we also followed them for a full year after their transplant. And in addition to knowledge and satisfaction, we also measured their medication adherence, because we wanted to know whether this type of education affected people at all on how they take their medications. And so we were doing pretty well with enrollment, but then unfortunately COVID happened, and that made everything challenging, as everybody knows. And so research basically halted. And then when we went up and going again, we were trying to enroll patients virtually, but ultimately we ended up closing the study early and we analyzed the results. And what we found is actually that not even 50% in the video group watched the videos, and there were no changes between the groups in any of our outcomes. So there was no difference. And so based on those two studies, one in the pre-transplant period and one in the post, we determined that, well, clearly we should put these before the transplant. That's when it seems to be more effective. And so we implemented them into our process in standard of care at our transplant program. And I think this bottom quote here from patients kind of really sums up what we were thinking too. So this patient says, "The series should be a requirement for everyone interested in kidney transplant prior to the testing or at the initial consultation meeting. The series answered a lot of questions and relieved confusion and stress, and I wish I viewed this at the beginning of the journey." And so, as I mentioned, we implemented this in the pre-transplant setting, and then we also went on and had translations done in both French and Cree, and those are on the patient portal at the Canadian Donation and Transplantation Research Network for others to access as well. And so I'm going to shift to Parag here, and he can tell you about his perspective.
Thanks so much, Holly. So again, you know, we'll kind of move forward a slide here, and you'll get to see my mug on the next slide. And we'll talk about, so everything in life is about stewardship. So for me, it was leading into the first question of why is that. You know, I was very fortunate that I had an excellent family support system. I mean, it starts with obviously dad giving me the kidney, but I had excellent family support, excellent friends and excellent caregivers. And I had a generally positive experience despite what is, a very complicated, very stressful time. And I was only like 15 when this all happened. So it's a life-changing event when you get a kidney transplant, no matter what. But more so when you're a kid. And so that kind of pushed me into like, well, this is what worked and this is what didn't work. And how can I make it better for the next guy? And so that kind of leads into the stewardship part. And so, fast forward, you know, through the recovery and I'm in my first or second year of pharmacy school, and Holly was at an open house night, basically where staff and faculty and students get to kind of mingle and learn about everything. And I just kind of walked out and said, "I'm a kidney transplant patient. I'm now in pharmacy school. I want to do something to help." And so for me, it was really important that I could give back, because I felt I had taken so much. And simply put, that, you know, transplantation is the cause of my life for my life. And so for me, it was really important that whatever I could do, I would do, just because it was just a deeply personal experience, as I'm sure anyone who's been through this or is going through this knows. And I just really, really wanted to contribute. And so that's kind of where it started. And as we go forward here, one more slide. You know, there's three questions here. Is this, what did the project get out of it? What did I get out of it? And what surprised me? The project kind of got a lot out of me, and I'm happy to have contributed as much as I did. Just as my transplantation journey is unique, my turn and my role as a research assistant is very unique. But the project kind of got a lot out of me. And so I'm a big hockey fan. We've got the trade deadline coming up tomorrow. I kind of looked at myself as that utility player that could kind of be slotted anywhere through the lineup, that if they needed me somewhere one day, I was there. If they needed me somewhere else the other day, I was there. So throughout the project, I got to do so many cool things. As Holly mentioned, I was walking around the hospital with you know, a tripod over my shoulder and the camera and a microphone bag and everything. And I'd go from room to room and I'd interview patients. I'd interview their families. I'd interview caregivers, healthcare providers, everybody. And so that was really cool. You see a picture there of when I got to meet a donor organ that got flown in overnight. I got to scrub in and film preparations that was on a donor organ as well. And so this is all very, very cool and a very unique experience to myself. But that flexibility and that kind of excited puppy in me that was able to help, the project got a lot out of it because I was able to kind of utilize, you know, my willingness and my experience as a patient, as well as that I was a pharmacy student, to kind of help. And what I got out of it was, in some way, a little bit of closure and catharsis because I had been there. I had experienced this as a patient, and now I got to kind of see what was going on in the background. And it was just a very unique, very cool thing, you know, that I got to partake in as a pharmacy student and as a patient. And, you know, I try not to get too emotional about it, but one of the biggest thing I got out of it was is that I got to witness patients' lives improving on the exact same floor in the exact same rooms that I was a patient as years before. And so this project is 10 years in the making, and I got involved 10 years after my kidney transplant. So for me, it was really just like a huge growth piece, but I really wanted to contribute. The biggest surprise, and you've kind of talked about it a little bit, but we'll talk about it more as we go along today, is that our fairly basic goal of educating patients as to why they have to take their medications, why they're going to be on them for lifelong, it grew into such a huge, huge different thing. And so it's kind of like a plant that we planted the seeds here, we watered it, we nurtured it, and it grew into something that we couldn't even believe. And my experience, like I said, was very different. I have to put that caveat out there. My time involvement was also much more different than what someone else might want. But it was just a really neat experience. So as we go forward here, this next slide shows exactly, you know, what it was like, is that we thought we were starting at one point and getting to another, and there were actually a lot of detours. And I think even this might be a little oversimplified in terms of just how many detours we took, how many off ramps we found that, you know, we had to divert due to whatever it was, is that, well, we need, you know, we have the pandemic now, or we had different challenges. And so you divert, then you get back on course, and then something else would happen. And so we had this growth that just this constantly moving target, which sounds frustrating, but it's actually really exciting because as it grows, you're kind of like you're in a big room and you start with a flashlight and things get brighter and suddenly you can see this whole room, and it started with just that one light bulb. So as we move forward, I think I'm going to pass it back to Holly.
Okay, so I'm just going to tell you a little bit about what happened after the kidney videos now. So as you can see, it was quite a time endeavor that we didn't really expect, as Prague alluded to. And basically from that project, there were several sort of other collaborations that grew and educational projects, which are listed, and I'm just going to briefly tell you about them. So we are continually amazed at how each of these projects is unique, and each is focused by patients in sort of different ways. And so this one is about lung transplant education. So basically from that project, some patients who volunteered with the Lung Association, Lung Saskatchewan, they had heard about the project and they had reached out to us to see if we could do something similar for lung population. And so we got some support from Lung Saskatchewan, and then this project basically took on a life of its own. So we formed new partnerships with new patients, and we did a new needs assessment. And once again, we had, you know, people involved in various capacities throughout the research. And I think the biggest take home for this one was that the lung patients really taught us the importance of caregivers and incorporating caregiver perspectives. And so we did a whole kind of side project just learning about the specific needs of caregivers and lung caregivers and the lung Lung Saskatchewan went on to create some resources specifically for them based on this work. So another thing is pediatric transplant education. So our pediatric nephrology group reached out and they said, hey, do you want to do something similar, or not necessarily similar, but do you want to help us improve education for the pediatric group? And so we partnered with the Canadian Society of Transplant Pediatric Educational Initiative. That's a really big mouthful, but basically what they are is a national collaboration to sort of improve education. And so we are in the midst of this right now. We have a really great group of engaged patients and caregivers, and we're working on the steps of this project. And we're really fortunate to have funding from the Kidney Foundation for this one. And so I'm hoping maybe in a couple of years I can come back and share the results of this. We also had a psychologist from the UK reach out to us from and basically ask us if we'd be willing to work with their team and their group to adapt our video series so that they could use it in the UK. And so we're currently working on that with her and her team, and they plan to basically reuse and recycle whatever they can, because there's no point reinventing the wheel if they don't have to. And so we're starting with patient consultations in the UK. And one of the things that has come up is our funny accents. So I suspect we will have to re-narrate some of the animations and put some of their patients in, which is totally not surprising at all. With all of this talk about sort of adapting and tailoring and recognizing the importance of patient stories, we set out to basically create an app to kind of deliver personalized education to patients. And so we got a team together and started some consultations. And again, we like totally pivoted based on what our patients told us. So we started with this prototype. We showed it to patients and basically they said, you know what, I feel like this is a little bit paternalistic and it's almost focused too much on illness. And really, like, we'd like something that can focus on wellness and help us to manage our health, kind of like a one-stop shop for transplant recipients. And so based on that feedback, we're basically in the process of kind of redoing and revamping the app so that it can better resonate with patients. And so this app is still in the development phase as well, but I'm really excited about its future potential. And once again, the Kidney Foundation is supporting this as well. And so I'm really thankful for that. So we're just going to wrap up with kind of what we learned about patient collaboration. And so for me, I think the thing that I've learned is that, or most, I would say up front, if someone asked me, is that authentic partnership is essential. And so it's nice that funding agencies are starting to realize the importance of, you know, appropriate patient engagement, but it's not enough to just have one patient on the team and tick a box and call it done. I think that patients are unique, or people are unique, and they should be treated as such. And so one patient partner isn't enough for the entire life cycle of a big project. And one person's lived experience can't possibly represent all. I think another thing is that patients can offer more than just their lived experience. And we've really found that through Prague's work and through Terry's work. And the last thing I would say is that the patient really needs to benefit from the project involvement as well. Obviously, you can tell what we get out of the project as researchers and healthcare providers, but it's got to be something that is worth your time and that's an experience that, you know, you can relate to and that you benefit from as well. Okay, Parag.
So from my end, thank you. So from my end, and I'm sorry I keep touching my ears, my earbuds today have just been falling out. I apologize, but perspective is everything. It's kind of the biggest thing that I came around. So we've got a simple cartoon that really illustrates that, is that one person sees a six and one person sees a nine. So everyone can contribute something else to this pyramid of care. The provider provides something, obviously, but patients, their family, anyone who's in that circle can see something just a little bit different. And those, like, those contributions, even if you think that they're small, actually make a huge, huge difference in the grand scheme of things. So the sum total of all these small contributions turns into quite the project, as you've been able to see. My story is unique, just as everyone else would be. And you know, I'm truly honored and blessed that, you know, for me, it came full circle. Like I said, like, I started off as a scared teenager in a hospital bed. And I just wanted to make it a little bit easier and not quite as scary, you know, instill a little braveness in people as they went along. And then I got into pharmacy school, and then I got involved in this as a patient. And full circle, I became a researcher in the same hospital, like I said, on the same floor. I had an office just around the corner from the same room that I was in as a patient. And so I got to contribute, again, it's a very unique perspective, but I got to contribute to that. Fast forward to today, 10 years later after that, I am a pharmacist, I'm a business owner. I still try and do as much as I can with kidney care. And the core concept between all of that is at the bottom there is that we do better when we all do better. And so what I can try and distill all of this in to anybody that is thinking about getting involved in research, whether you're a provider, whether you're a caregiver, or whether you're the patient yourself, is that no contribution is too small, because you might be that missing link that provides that extra information, that extra boost, that extra perspective that changes everything and kind of makes life better for the next person in line. And you know, 10 years of a life commitment is pretty big, but no one would ever, you know, it's not a cell phone contract that you're locked into or anything like that. When you sign up, it's however much time you want to give. And that's the one thing I would really encourage people is that just like my experiences were unique, that I got to meet the plane in the middle of the night and I got to scrub in and film certain things in the OR. That's not everyone's experience, just as my transplant journey was not everyone's experience. But you get to experience something unique and different and put that perspective in, and it makes a huge, huge difference in the grand scheme of things. So just like, again, I'll distill it. We do better when we all do better. So I encourage you all to get involved, because that's how things get better.
So I think that leads really well into the last slide, which is really, it's just a team effort. And we've just been blessed to work with so many amazing people throughout the project. And like, I never would have imagined that just this little idea would grow and take us down this path. And the people that are mentioned here are just honestly a handful of the people that wouldn't fit all on the slide. And so I want to thank all of the people that have been involved. And I really want to acknowledge the funding agencies as well. And so it's networks like the Kidney Foundation that provide the support to make this stuff possible. And I think it's also worth mentioning that they also sort of set the tone for the type of research, the type of work that's being supported. And so having this meeting today really reflects on the priorities that the Kidney Foundation has. And I think they're definitely in the right place involving patients. So thank you so much for your time. And we are available to answer any questions.
Thank you so much, Holly and Craig. So we're actually going to go to our second presentation, and then what we'll do at the end is we'll have a question period. I believe Carrie nod your head for everybody to ask questions to all of our presenters today. So we're just going to take a moment to switch gears. Bear with me while I share my screen. All right, there we go. So we invited Holly and Craig to come today to give you a specific example of a research project, or actually really a research program that was presented that really benefited from the inclusion of patients and caregivers and those with lived experience. So it was a very sort of specific, broad-reaching example. The presentation was excellent. Thank you so much to both of you. But we did want to take a couple of minutes to go over just lived experience in research in general. So I always like to start these presentations off a little bit about discussing why research is different. So those of you that are attending today probably have attended some other sessions, or I hope you have, for our patient forum that discuss a lot of the educational and support and program activities that the Kidney Foundation of Canada is focused on, which are all amazing and important and integral to the work that we do in supporting our community. But research really differs from some of those things in that it's one of the things that gives hope for the next generation or the next person going through the journey. So you heard Parag talking about how, you know, I wanted to take away some of the stress or increase the bravery of the person that's going through this after me. And research is one of those things that we can do that's very forward looking, right? We're taking a problem that exists today and we're really looking at how can we change that in the future. And I think it's really important to just circle back to this idea that everybody is an expert. So in the past, there was this group, this glass ceiling of sort of doctors and people who wear the white coats, like Parag said, he mentioned he had his white coat on. And then, you know, the normal people, everyone else who's in sort of like this other little group. And I think that over the last I'd say 20 years at this point, but really accelerating over the last 10 years, has been this idea that we can really break down this ceiling and this wall between, and everybody can work together, bringing their expertise to the table. So everybody has expertise that's really important to how we move research forward, which was wonderfully illustrated in Holly and Craig's presentation. So what's the Kidney Foundation of Canada doing to integrate lived experience into their programs and into their research? And how, what are we doing to support that? So I've put a couple of examples here up on the slide, and these are, you know, definitely not the only things that we do, but some of the things we wanted to highlight today. So one, lived experience priorities are integrated into our research strategy. You'll notice I'm using the term lived experience rather than patient. This is because we really want to make sure that we're incorporating everybody who's participating in this kidney journey. So really recognizing that, you know, there's caregivers, there's parents, there's spouses, there's, you know, your best friend, there's living kidney donors, there's people who feel like they used to be patients, but maybe they're not patients anymore. We've had some feedback on this, the use of the patient term. Some people really don't like it. So we're trying to transition into this lived experience term. So if anybody's wondering what that means, that's why we use that. For our research projects, so we do fund research, as Holly mentioned. Our applicants are really encouraged to include people with lived experience on their research projects. In their research teams, they're allowed to have them as co-applicants, and they're encouraged to discuss how they're going to translate the knowledge of their work back to the community. So as a funder, you get the joy of being able to set the tone of what people kind of, I'll say, have to do or are encouraged to do to be successful. And one of those things is really opening the doors for making sure that we do have this lived experience inclusion. At the foundation ourselves, we do have lived experience partners who play a role in peer review. So this is actually reviewing grants that come in the door and play a role in deciding, you know, does this align with patient priority? Is this something that I'm passionate about and interests me? And we're going to talk about that a little bit later in the presentation. We also have a patient and community advisory network. They participate in our capacity building program, which is called Crescent. All of these programs are available on our website under the research section if you'd like to learn more about them. This is a group of really, really dedicated volunteers who are patients, caregivers, who contribute to helping to train the next generation of scientists. So they train them how to write lay summaries that people understand, or how to integrate people into their work and the importance of that lived experience voice. We also actively fund and partner with other lived experience focused networks and organizations and partnerships to help work together to change the culture of research. And I think, Craig, you said this wonderful statement at the end of your presentation, but we all do better if we all do better. And I think that it's really important to mention that we really work together with a lot of these organizations. It's not a competition. We're trying to work together for the betterment of our community. And today we've actually invited a representative from one of these organizations to give a brief overview of some of the things that they are doing to help increase the focus of lived experience and patient inclusion in research. So at this point, I would like to introduce Graham. Graham Pollock is the Communications and External Relations Lead at the CanSolve CKD Network. It's a very fancy title. And in this role, he oversees the network's communications portfolio, leads the development and execution of strategies to increase awareness of innovative kidney research to a wide range of audiences. So this includes partners like us, as well as audience like you. And Graham also leads the network's efforts to develop and maintain strong relationships with funding partners and external organizations such as us. And he's going to take you through what CanSolve CKD is, how they're important, and what the wonderful work is that they've been doing over the last couple of years to look at patient-oriented research. So over to you, Graham.
Thanks very much, Leanne. Really appreciate the invitation to be here today. And I know at CanSolve CKD, we say that everything we do is made possible by our partners. And so I just wanted to acknowledge that the Kidney Foundation is truly our most important partner and funder. And I think we're so grateful for all the support that we've had over the years for our research. And it's a real pleasure to be able to be here today and highlight some of the work that we've been able to achieve in that partnership. I'd just also like to mention with gratitude that I live and work in Vancouver on the unceded territory of the Coast Salish peoples, which is home to the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh nations. So CanSolve CKD is a national research organization that is focused on improving kidney health. And what makes us unique is that everything we do is in partnership with people who are living with and affected by kidney disease. So we have an extensive community of not just patients, also donors, care partners, other family members. As Leanne was mentioning, we're broadening the terminology to focus more on the lived experience of kidney disease. And so what we do is we work with a lot of these individuals and really try to center our work around their priorities and their perspectives. And we work by bringing them together with researchers, care providers, policymakers, and others in the kidney health space who can help design and execute research projects that are informed at their core by what is most important to people who are affected by kidney disease. If we could just go to the next slide, please.
Oh, that's strange. I apologize.
Oh, that's
wing it, Graham.
That's okay. All good. So I mean, we have a number of initiatives that are in progress across the country, but I think at its core, our work is really focused on three main themes. So one is changing the culture of kidney research. And what we mean by that is that we're working to make research more centered around the priorities that have been identified by patients, by donors, care partners, and involving those individuals in our work, not just as research subjects, which I think is traditionally how patients and others have been involved in research, but as true partners in everything we do. So they are they're extensively involved as members of research teams that are actually helping to design and deliver some of these studies and publish the results and share those with the community afterwards. So it's a really intensive level of involvement, and it really brings the patient and lived experience perspective to the forefront. The other theme of our work is generating new knowledge about kidney health. So we have a robust research program. We've had 27 projects that we've supported since 2016 that are focused on topics such as earlier diagnosis, better treatments, using technology to develop innovative approaches to care. And out of that, we've created a number of new treatment and education interventions, some e-health decision aids, and a number of clinical trials looking at new treatment approaches. And finally, I'll just mention that we've created a number of resources to help bring patients and researchers together more effectively to work on research projects. So we've created some training modules to help enhance people's skills to do this type of research. And also we've created a novel platform in partnership with the Kidney Foundation. This is called Kidney Link, and I know Leanne's going to speak about this more in a minute, so I'll turn it back to her, but just wanted to say that, I think this is a really exciting opportunity for people to get involved in research, to learn a little bit more about what that looks like and find opportunities, and we're thrilled to be able to do this in partnership with the Kidney Foundation. So if you'd like to learn more about our work, I would encourage you to check out our website at the bottom of the slide there, cansolveckd.ca. And with that, I'll just say thanks and turn it back to you, Leanne.
Bonus points for Graham, being able to present without a second slide. Really appreciate it. Sorry about that, Graham. Not sure what happened there. CanSolve CKD is one of our most important partners in terms of really looking at the patient-oriented research space. Their website is there on the bottom of the slide. I believe it may also go into the chat. And anyone who's interested in learning more, please, we encourage you to reach out. So, the biggest question that I get when I present, lived experience is really important in research. It's super rewarding. It's awesome. The first question I get is, how can I get involved? So people seem to be very interested in the idea, but a little bit lost as to what they can do. How do they get there, right? Tag said, I just walked up to Holly and said, I want to do it. I want to be involved. And that's great, but it's not everybody's experience, as he mentioned, right? Everybody's in a very different position. So, how can somebody who's gone through this journey or who is in this journey or is going to have to go through this journey really get involved in the research space? So there's a couple of ways that this is, that you can look at to participate. So the first is to be a participant in studies. We talked about this. This is kind of the classic way, that everybody thinks of when we engage patients in research. It's still really important. It's really important that patients are willing to, fill out surveys and participate in clinical trials and have their voice heard in the research landscape. I think that we by providing other options, we don't want to discount this option as well. This can often be a very low time commitment option depending on the project, and it's still super important. We do have a list of studies available for participation on our website under our Get Involved section. So I'd encourage people to check that out. The second is to engage with a research program as a patient partner. So this is a little bit different, and researchers themselves still sometimes have a little bit of a trouble understanding the difference between a participant and a partner. A partner is somebody like Parag who's engaged on the research team, who's involved in decision-making, might be involved in, you know, knowledge translation and communicating results or speaking to other patients in project design, will participate in writing scientific studies, things like this. So people who are actively included on the research team as an equal valued team member. We'll talk a little bit more about the program that Graham mentioned, KidneyLink, in a moment, which could help set you up if you're interested in becoming a patient partner. Of course, for any of these things, if you want to know more, you're always welcome to reach out to the Kidney Foundation of Canada, and we'll make sure to point you in the right direction. Another thing that you could do is act as a peer reviewer for our research competitions. So as I mentioned, we do peer review all our grants, and we are currently actually recruiting peer reviewers for some of our competitions. You do get training, support is provided, and mentorship, and we'll talk about that on the next slide. And the last thing that you could look into doing is sitting on governance or steering committees to help set priorities. So this could be with an organization such as ours. It could be with an organization such as Graham's at CanSolve. It could also be through your local hospital or your local care unit. A lot of hospitals do have patient and community advisory committees, you know, really putting your voice out there and having a say on how things go. So we did mention KidneyLink. We would really like to highlight KidneyLink today. This is a partnership between the Kidney Foundation and CanSolve CKD, which is an online portal to help patients, caregivers, and those with lived experience connect with the research space. So it does do a couple of things that we're going to highlight quickly today. First, it has a list of studies that are looking to recruit patient partners. So in some times, they're also looking for participants, but often these studies are actually looking for patients to be engaged on their research team. So you can see that on the left-hand side of the slide there is an example of some of the projects that were listed when we took the screenshot. I can't guarantee that they're listed currently, but this is continuously updated. So researchers will come to us when they're looking for help connecting to a lived experience partner. You'll see on the extreme left there, you can look at different types of participation. Like Parag said, maybe you don't want to spend the same kind of time and commitment I did. There's lots of different levels and ways that you can participate, all that are completely equally valuable. We've also hired a scientific writer who participates in helping to translate knowledge of some of the research that's happening into easily digestible, proper English language, not our scientific language that has 12,000 acronyms and doesn't really make sense to most people who are outside of the space, including other scientists, I will mention. If you're not directly involved in the space, those acronyms can be equally as difficult. So this is a way for us to help come full circle and make sure that the result or the research that we're supporting is also being translated back to the communities that it matters to. So there's some research results. And there's also some connection to resources. So Graham mentioned CanSolve CKD has developed an impressive and incredible library of resources to help those with lived experience get engaged in research. And those are also available through this site. So I would encourage you to check it out. And I believe the links for that are also going in the chat. Another thing we've recently done, this is also in partnership with CanSolve, as well as several other partners, including the Canadian and Donation and Transplantation Research Program and the Canadian Nephrology Trials Network, is we have developed a learning module. It's online, it's free, you don't have to sign up for anything, there's no username, to help you understand what it means to participate in a peer review process as a lived experience partner. It's super easy to use. It's available in French and English. You can find it on our website under the Engage in Research section, which is shown at the bottom of that slide. If this is something that you're maybe interested in, but you don't really know what it means, this might be a good first stop for you. We're really looking to build our resource library to help people get engaged. And you'll see in that nice pink circle there, we're also currently recruiting for peer reviewers. So if this is something that you might be interested in, we'd encourage you to go and take a look at that site as well. I just wanted to close out today. We're going to have some time for questions, but people with lived experience have expertise that cannot be replicated. It can't be replicated by clinicians or researchers or health administrators like myself and Graham. It can only be given to research teams from people who have walked the walk, sat in the hospital bed, and gone through the emotional and psychological pieces of what they've had to do. So please do not feel that because you don't have PhD after your name, you don't have MD after your name, you don't have pharmacy after your name, that you have nothing to add to these research teams. That's just not, it's just not the case. And your insight and viewpoint can really help researchers and clinicians and researcher programs develop, complete, and communicate their work in a way that resonates to people who matter most, and that is those in our community who are going through this journey. So we'd like to encourage everybody to reach out or to connect through our website or KidneyLink, to check out the CanSolve CKD website if you're interested in learning more and getting involved. And that's it for my presentation. So I'm going to stop sharing. And I think we're going to have a little short question period.
Thank you, Leanne. So we do have a few minutes for questions if anybody has questions for Leanne or Holly or Parag. Before we get into it, though, I do want to say thank you for the valuable insights that you all gave us into what it means to be a patient participant or a patient partner in research. You've really given us an idea of what that's like and why we should do it. Thank you as well to Graham and Leanne for getting into the details of the how people can get involved in research. So maybe we can start actually with the question for Parag. It's really wonderful to hear how committed you've been to improving the kidney journey for the people who are coming after you. We've certainly been fortunate seeing the same thing with the people with lived and living experience we work with every day at the foundation. What advice would you give to someone who is thinking about getting involved in research?
Go for it. It's simple, but it's the best thing is that there's no contribution that is too small. And just the fact that you're thinking of it is that first indicator that you want to make that difference. And even if it's just confirming that what you've been through, you know, that it worked, that's fine, because that's how the research process works. We've talked about it ad nauseum today, but if I put my pharmacist coat on, I can't say what I saw as a patient and vice versa, right? So until you put that involvement in there, don't assume that we've got it figured out, because that's not how this works. And so if you're thinking about it, go for it and just talk to whoever your contact person is, whether it's your transplant team or we've seen the links today to, you know, all those different things. It's just put yourself out there just a little bit. It doesn't cost you anything, but the reward, not only on a personal growth side, but for that next person is tremendous. So if you're thinking about it, go for it. You will not believe the satisfaction that comes out of it.
Thanks very much, Parag. I have a question now for Holly, actually. It's fantastic to see how many developments have come out of that original project. And I wonder if you can speak a little bit more to how patients were brought into the project. How were people made aware of the opportunity?
Thank you. That's a really good question. I feel like we started very much center specific, like it was a Saskatchewan project. We were doing this to improve for our program. And so I feel like probably everybody was sick of us after a couple of years, because we advertised a lot. We talked about it a lot. I feel like the people that we had involved often were serendipitous. It was somebody said to us, hey, I want to do this or I want to do that. And then we would talk about it. And we kind of did the same thing with respect to filming. We would, you know, mention casually in conversation that we're creating this video series, and people would kind of volunteer, express an interest, and we would say, hey, okay, we'll film you if you're interested, kind of thing. So we did a lot of talking just kind of internally with our program. But then it kind of grew like to the next level. And then at that point, you know, I would say through our collaborators from other centers, you know, they started to introduce it to their sites. And then definitely through some of the networks, we really benefited, like the CDTRP and you know, just networks where researchers were sharing information as well. So I didn't have a great strategy to begin with, because as you can see, it kind of all just kind of went with, you know, the wind a little bit. but that's surprisingly sometimes how research goes.
Thank you. That is really interesting that it's developed kind of essentially by word of mouth, and yeah, that is the way it does happen a lot of the time. So thank you for sharing that. Do we have any other questions from the audience?
Can I add?
Yeah, please do.
I think that the way that it happened for Holly is sort of the way that it's been happening for a lot of researchers, right? They have connections with people, they see people, you know, day to day. But I also think that that's part of the reason that people like Graham and I and our respective organizations have been working at, like, how can we advertise these studies, you know, for the researchers, but also for patients to get involved, because people may or may not be in those serendipitous places. They might be, you know, actually looking for opportunities. So that was part of the impetus for creating KidneyLink and for putting these studies online, is so that people have a place to go, right? They have a hub to go to say, hey, I'm really interested in research, but I don't know how to connect or how to get engaged. So that was part of why we've been working to develop some of those resources as well, both to help the researchers not have to do it, you know, fly by night, but also to help patients know where to go to get connected.
Thanks, Leanne. And I'd like to just ask whether there are any further questions from the audience. We haven't, sometimes it's a lot of information to take in. A lot of the links are in the chat, so feel free to visit those links, please do, to get involved on your own and to learn more about how to do that. Okay, seeing none, don't hesitate to reach out to kidneyprograms@kidney.ca. If there are any questions that you that come to you after the session that you would like to see some answers to, I do actually see one already coming up. So are your websites available for use in our peer support programs?
I'm assuming we mean, like, are you able to share them in your peer support programs, or do you mean Holly's video program? Either, I suppose, would be available for use in peer support programs, or for communication in a patient-to-patient communication. Mm-hmm. So absolutely, please feel free to share. They're all, Holly's programs are publicly available. She put a couple of links to them, but we can also share them out more. And I believe we're looking at connecting them to some of our Kidney Foundation resources as well. So we can definitely provide links to that.
Yep, it's absolutely the plan to include a link to Holly's videos in our new patient and caregiver portal, which is called kidneyinfo.ca. So you can look for those on there soon, along with other resources that'll be helpful in your journey. Thank you very much to Holly and Prague and Graham and Leanne for sharing your expertise with us today and really illuminating why and how it's important to get involved in kidney research. We appreciate it very much. And thank you to everyone in the audience for joining our session today. We hope that you're going to take the opportunity to support the research innovation that is moving us all closer to a future without kidney disease. Okay, thanks very much, and see you in a minute.